So I'm Gert-Jan, I'm here to discuss our joint work regarding quantified class constraints. So I'm going to quickly run through some background to be able to more easily explain our motivation. So as most of us know, type classes were first introduced by Butler and Blot to introduce ad hoc polymorphism to the language. So it works as follows. If you want to overload a certain function, you define a corresponding type class and introduce this function as a method to the class. Then each type which instantiates this class has to provide implementation for this method, for instance, for characters or for booleans and so on. Now you can go slightly more complex to, for instance, something like polymorphic lists. So the interesting part here is any list is an instance of the equality class, given that its contents are an instance of the equality class as well, since we need to be able to compare elements of type A. Now the Haskell compiler will accumulate all these declarations, translate them into a form of logical formulas as follows. So the instance we just saw is translated like this. Given that we get an explicit proof for the equality on A, the declaration shows us how to construct them for the equality on lists of A. And a class declaration with superclasses works the other way around. So given that we know that A is an instance of the ORT class, then it has to be an instance of the superclass EQ as well. So the compiler will accumulate all these logical formulas and place them into the program theory where they can be used to entail constraints. So let's take a look at a small example. Let's say we want to entail the following constraint. So the equality on tuples of natural numbers and booleans. So we select an axiom from the program theory, in this case one for tuples, which requires us to check both the equality of natural numbers and booleans, both of which are in the program theory, so our constraint is entailed. Now, Haskell is currently quite limited in what it allows with these quantified class constraints. So what we want to do is extend this with quantified class constraints. So we want to extend it from simple type class constraints to accept more complex constraints containing constraint implication and type abstraction and arbitrary positions nested inside the constraints. So the reason we want to do this is twofold. Firstly, these constraints allow for more precise specifications, enabling for a more expressive language. And secondly, they enable terminating resolution for a larger set of applications. So we're going to take a look at two small examples for both of these. Firstly, consider the well-known monotransformers. So a monotransformer is usually represented in Haskell through the transformer class. So a transformer T has a lift method which can lift a monadic value of type MA into TM of A. Now, the property that it can lift any monad M into a new monad TM can't actually be made explicit in Haskell at the moment. So we either leave it implicit or even place it in comments, but in any case, the type system doesn't have access to this information. So if you now take a look at the form of transformer composition, as defined by Schreves and Oliveira, we can define this as an instance of the transformer class. So given that both T1 and T2 are transformers, then we define the composition transformer as well by redefining the lift. So we take a value x of type MA, we lift it into T2 of MA, and then we lift the whole thing again into T1 of T2 of MA. However, in order to apply this second lift, we need to know that T2 of M is a monad, and the type system can't verify this. However, using quantified class constraints, we can do this. We can make the property we talked about earlier explicit. We can explicitly state that the transformer T can take any monad M into a new monad TM. And using this property, and the fact that T2 is a transformer and M is a monad, we now know that T2 of M is always a monad as well, and we can apply the second lift. So let's take a look at the second example, where termination poses an issue. So consider the Rose Tree data type, as presented by Hinze and Payton Jones, which consists of a single node of type A, and then a list of Rose Trees. Or alternatively, we can abstract over this list and define it as a general Rose Tree, where we take an explicit argument F for the collection. Now, we can define this general Rose Tree as an instance of, let's say, the show class, which we do as follows. So a Rose Tree is showable, given that its node is showable, and that the branches are showable. So this instance is quite sensible. However, we now take a look at a small example. Let's say we want to entail the following constraint. So we match against the head of our instance declaration, requiring us to check the premise. Now, show for Booleans is easily dischargeable, but for the second part, we require a top-level defined instance for lists. So this one. So we match again against the head of our instance, requiring us to check the premise. And you already see the issue. We encounter the same constraint over and over again. So our resolution algorithm is looping and it will diverge. And this is exactly where these quantified class constraints come in. They allow us to write the instance declaration as follows. So now we don't require that both the node and the branches are showable, but we require that the node is showable and that the F collection is always showable given that its contents are showable. When we now write the instance like this, and we take a look at the same example, so we again match against the head of our instance, requiring us to check the premise. Show for Booleans is still easily dischargeable. And the second part is exactly the formula you get from the from top-level defined instance for lists. So we actually skip the recursive step and thus enable for terminating resolution. Alternatively, Lemmel and Peyton-Jones encountered a similar issue a couple of years later, and they implemented a form of cycle-aware constraint resolution instead of using quantified class constraints. So what this means is that the resolution algorithm will detect loops, and when a loop is found in resolution, it will tie the recursive knot and entail the constraint. And this works quite well, and it's even been implemented in GHC. However, it has one main disadvantage, namely that it only works for a very specific set of applications, namely those where the resolution actually cycles. And this is not always the case. So let's take a look at a second example. So consider the perfect tree data type, as presented by Hinze, which either consists of a single node of type A, or of a perfect tree of tuples. So we can present it like this, or alternatively, we can make it slightly more complex and present it as a higher order fixed point combinator of a higher order functor. So we define our functor mu, our fixed point combinator mu, and we define our functor by abstracting over the perfect tree in the end and taking the F collection. Then we redefine our perfect tree as being the fixed point combinator of our H perfect functor. So it's slightly more complex. We can still define this as an instance of the show class by requiring that both mu and H perfect are showable, which you do as follows. So again, our instances are quite sensible, but when we now take a look at an example, let's say we want to entail this constraint. We know that perfect is a type pseudonym, so we inline the definition. We match against the head of our mu instance, requiring us to check the premise. We then match against the head of our H-perfect instance, again requiring us to check the premise. Show of integers is immediately dischargeable. And you already see the issue, actually. In order to check mu of H-perfect of integers, you're now checking mu of H-perfect of tuples of integers, so the size of the contained type is actually increased. And as you can imagine, this trend will continue. So we don't encounter the same constraint over and over again, so we're not technically looping. But our type system will still diverge, and the cycle-aware resolution algorithm can't help us here. However, using quantified class constraints, we can now represent the instances as follows. So the instances become slightly more complex. But when we now take a look at the same example, we again inline the definition for perfect. So we then match against the head of our mu instance, requiring us to check the premise. Show of integers is again immediately dischargeable. And the second part is exactly the formula we get from the second instance declaration. So we again skip the recursive step, thus enabling for terminating resolution. Now, just this Monday, I was sitting right here listening to an interesting talk by Michael Spivey. And in his paper, he had the following piece of code. Now, I'm not going to explain what it does, because he's going to be much better at that than I am. But you might already see what I'm about to find out. This right there is a quantified class constraint. And in his paper, he notes that this is exactly how he'd like to present his code, how he'd like to turn his idea into code. But Haskell doesn't allow this at the moment. So he had to go through quite some hoops, making a workaround to be able to express this piece of code, making it significantly more complex. So just a side note that even right here at ICFP, this feature is still very much requested. So, as you can imagine, the main difference regarding our typing specification is a specification of constraint entailment. So we represent constraint attainment as follows. So we take a program theory P, which, as I mentioned before, contained all the logical formulas we talked about, a typing context gamma, and I want to entail a wanted constraint C, which you do with the following five rules. So a constraint can either be in the program theory, in which case we entail it immediately. We introduce introduction and elimination rules for type abstraction respectively, and we do the same for constraint application. Now these rules are fairly easy to read, and they're in fact the standard rules for a subset of first order logic called Herb formulas. But they have one main disadvantage, namely that they're highly ambiguous. So let's take a look at a small example. Let's say you want to entail the following constraint, the show A constraint. We can note that it's immediately in the program theory, this entailing it immediately, or we can introduce constraint application, in which case we continue solving the left-hand side. So we assume the premise, placing it into the program theory. Note that show A is in the program theory, so entail it. And do the same for the right-hand side. So the point being, it's easy to see that infinitely many derivations may exist for entailing the same constraint, which is really not something we want. So what we did is the following. We introduced a second specification based on the focusing technique previously used by Schermers, Oliveira, and Wattler. Now, you may note that the focusing technique originates from proof search. So we presented our entailment based on two helper relations. We have our entailment relation, which takes, again, a program theory P and a type in context gamma, and then wants to entail a wanted constraint C. And it does so by starting to deconstruct C until we reach a class constraint form, in which case we have to select a given axiom from the program theory, match it against our wanted class constraint Q, thus simplifying it into a set of residual constraints A. Now, both of these rules are completely syntax-directed either on the wanted constraint C or on the given axiom C. So both of them have three possible rules for the three possible syntactic forms. So a constraint can either be in constraint application, in which case we assume the premise placing it into the program theory, or type abstraction, in which case we scolemize the type variable B, placing it into the typing context and just making it form a fixed constant. Or finally, when we reach a class constraint form, we select an axiom C from the program theory, match against it using our matching relation, thus simplifying the wanted constraint into a set of residual constraints A, which are then recursively resolved. So we can take a look at the matching relation, which again has three possible forms. So the given axiom is either a constraint application, in which case we assume the premise continue with the head of the constraint, or type abstraction, in which case you have to instantiate the type variables with a suitable type to later on match against the wanted class constraint, and two class constraint match once they're completely identical. Now using these two rules, we can then define our constraint entailment as being equivalent to the first helper relation. Now these rules already solve a major portion of our non-determinism issue, but there are still two points of non-determinism remaining. We still have to select an axiom from the program theory to match against, and we still need to instantiate the type variables with some suitable type tau. Now, for our inference algorithm, we've thus chosen to use a form of search with backtracking to be able to select axioms without losing expressivity. And we postpone the instantiation of type variables as much as possible until all the way at the end when we unify the two class constraints, resulting in a type substitution, which can then be used to instantiate the type variables. So our main point of interest in our inference algorithm is the fact that we use backtracking in order not to lose expressivity, that we use unification. We work incrementally, so we don't solve the constraints immediately, but just simply propagate residuals upwards. And finally, we elaborate our program into SysMF, since it's the most commonly used intermediary language for functional programming. So we're not going to show the rules here, because they get kind of technical. But I'm going to show the signatures, and we're going to take a look at a small example. So let's say you want to entail the following constraint, so the constraint on the left-hand side. Now, we focus on the wanted constraint, deconstructing it to the class constraint form. So we strip off the type abstraction. We assume the premise of our constraint implication, placing it into the program theory. So we've reached a class constraint form, so we now select an axiom from the program theory, a given axiom to match against. In this case, one for lists. So we start focusing on this given axiom. We deconstruct it by stripping off the type abstraction. We assume the premise, stripping off our constraint implication. So we've now reached two class constraints. So we unify the two, resulting in a substitution which maps A onto B, which is then propagated downwards. We need to be a bit more careful here, though, because we assumed our premise, but we still need to check it. So we apply our type substitution, and then propagate the residual constraints all the way downwards. So we've now simplified our left constraint into the right one, which still needs to be recursively checked. So we again match against our, we again focus on our wanted constraint, stripping off the type abstraction, assuming the premise of our constraint application. So we then select an axiom from the program theory to match against. Both of them are already class constraints, so we unify the two, resulting in an empty substitution, which is propagated all the way downwards, resulting in no residual constraints. We've completely solved our wanted constraint. Now, a final interesting point in our work is that of the meta theory aspect. So one of the most interesting parts is the termination of our constraint entailment. So I'm going to present it a bit more intuitively. We represent our resolution algorithm, or resolution derivation, as a resolution tree. So each node in the tree corresponds to a wanted constraint, and each edge corresponds to applying an axiom from the program theory to this constraint, simplifying it into a set of residual constraints, namely the children. So each path in the tree corresponds to a possible derivation. We then define a basic norm for types. We require that applying an axiom from the program theory always strictly decreases the norm of the contained type in the head of the constraint. So because of this, and the fact that our norm is always a natural number, we know that no infinite paths may exist in our derivation, and that resolution has to terminate. However, for superclass axioms, this requirement is simply too strong. So we require that by applying a superclass axiom to a wanted constraint, the norm cannot increase in size. So it either has to decrease or remain constant. But you then add two additional requirements that only a finite number of superclasses may exist, and that the superclass relation has to form a directed acyclic graph. So because of this, each series of consecutive applications of superclass axioms is always bounded in size by the height of the directed acyclic graph. So after a finite number of steps, the resolution either has to terminate or apply an axiom from, or apply an instance or local axiom, the strictly decreasing the norm. So again, no infinite paths may exist, and resolution has to terminate. A second interesting point is that of non-determinism. So given that we allow for overlapping superclass axioms, we know that our system is not deterministic. However, due to the fact that all computational content arises from instances, and that, as is common in Haskell, we don't allow for overlapping instances, we are quite confident that even though our system is not deterministic and multiple possible derivations may exist, the system is coherent. So all the possible derivations will still result in the same eventual computational content. The second aspect of this is the following. So consider the following instance, which is translated into the following formula. If we were to match against the head of this formula, we'd have to instantiate the type variable A with some type. But choosing a different type might result in a different derivation and even different computational content in the end. So standard Haskell requires that all quantified variables and constraints have to appear in the head of the constraint. But given that our constraints are slightly more complex, we have to generalize this requirement into the following relation. So looks quite daunting, but it's quite simple. It simply accumulates all quantified variables and requires that they're in the head of the constraint. So we require that all axioms in our program theory are unambiguous, so we're quite confident of our coherency claim. So I've presented an overview of our work, but there are still quite a few points of future work remaining. Firstly, we've started proving the soundness of our algorithm with our focusing-based specification, but the completeness and the preservation of types during elaboration are still interesting points of future work. Secondly, our system extends Haskell with quantification over types and constraints, but it could be quite interesting to see how we could extend it with quantification over predicates, so over constraints, since this would make the system even more expressive to the extent of a subset of second-order logic. Thirdly, it would be quite interesting to see how this system behaves in interaction with several mainstream GHC features, such as functional dependencies or type classes. in order to later on implement it in GXC. And finally, we're quite confident that there are quite a few other problems in Haskell which could be solved using these quantified class constraints. For instance, the ticket linked below is a problem with coercions in GHC, which we're quite confident which could be solved with these quantified class constraints, given a bit more extra work. So I've presented an overview of our work. If you're interested, definitely read the paper. It's highly recommended. So it contains quite a few extra points, like some more examples, all the nitty-gritty details of our inference algorithm, including the elaboration aspect. Finally, we've also implemented this extension in a basic Haskell prototype compiler. So if you're interested, definitely download the code, try out a few examples yourself. Okay, so is there any comments or questions? Now is a perfect time. Thanks.
When can I play with it?
Well, you can download the prototype compiler, and we plan on implementing this in GHC later on, but not yet in.
Has there been a discussion on GHC about whether that sounds great or not? Like, it sounds great.
Dependent types? Not quite sure.
That's a polymorphic question.
Yeah, I'm not quite sure. Right now, we've simply elaborated to System F with data types. But in order for us to implement this in GHC, of course, we're going to have to elaborate to a core language. Yeah.
I was wondering how it interacts with type family.
Well, so am I. No, it's we haven't yet investigated that far. It could be quite interesting to see, because I think type families introduce type equalities, which will make the constraint entailment slightly more difficult. But I definitely don't think it's impossible or anything. It simply needs to be investigated further on.
I'm curious how this compares to... So the current hack that we have to do is to define, show one and eq one class.
Yeah.
Other than boilerplate, how does this differ? What more does this give me than the hack?
Yeah, yeah. So we have compared against that solution, obviously. I think it's proposed by Trifonov, who has quite some work on that. But the problem is, when you do that, the code can get quite complex and much, much harder to read when you can simply express it like this. Like the paper I mentioned from Spivy on Monday, he said, like, oh, we can write it like this, would be so much easier.
Yeah,
but instead, we have to.
Work. I was just curious if there's.
Yeah, no.
Yeah. I just didn't know if you had any examples of that.
The paper contains a few examples, I think. It's definitely quite easy to see that the code becomes much, much easier to read. It's very intuitive to represent it instead of writing additional classes and. I didn't get
it.
I'm not sure what constraint kinds are, to be honest.
The kind of comported constraints.
Yeah, yeah. That's actually a very good question. I'm not quite sure. we should definitely talk about it afterwards. I'm quite curious myself.
Okay, there are no more questions.